Welcome to BBC What's New. This week we're talking about elephants, the gentle giants of the animal kingdom. 37 countries across Africa feel the weight of their feet, but recently, the world's largest mammal made headlines because of a grim discovery in Asia. Nearly 9 tons of ivory from 300 African elephants were found smuggled into Singapore. So, why is this still happening? We asked one young reporter from Kenya to find out for us.
Hi, my name is Chantal. I'm 15 years old, and welcome to the Elephant Orphanage in Nairobi. And it's here that the casualties of an illegal trade have been brought to life. Many of the Watoto Watembo, or baby elephants, have been brought here because their parents were killed by poachers. And I've been looking at why. Every day, this elephant orphanage opens its doors to visitors who rush to get close to one of Africa's most famous attractions, its wildlife. Families are invited to sponsor or adopt the residents here, dozens or hundreds of baby elephants. But behind the giant ears and probing trunks is a tale of loss, because the majority of the animals here have lost their parents to poachers. So, Mr. Lusichi, are you a conservationist here?
Yes, I'm a conservationist here. We are taking care of orphan baby elephants and rhinos and reintroducing them back into the wild.
Oh, so how exactly do the elephants get you?
The elephants come here because they've been left alone. Something wrong has happened to the mothers. And most obvious reason is poaching. Some of them, the mothers have been killed by poachers due to the trade on ivory. And that's why they've been left alone and they're still young, below the age of 2, where they cannot survive without the mother's milk, and that's why we bring them in. Some are here because they've been separated from their families by human beings, what we call human-wildlife conflict. And a few are here because of natural reasons, like the mothers have died from old age, natural diseases and starvation back into the wild. The strict laws against poaching have really helped to reduce the number of orphans that are coming in because of poaching. Although we still have some orphans coming in because of other reasons, but before we used to have like 80% of the orphans coming in because of ivory poaching. And now we do have like about 30 to 40% of orphans coming in because of poaching. So that has really reduced.
The orphanage has raised 244 elephants so far, and a recent discovery in Asia suggests that that number isn't likely to go down anytime soon. Ivory tusks from hundreds of African elephants were seized by authorities in Singapore. The illegal cargo had been hidden in a container from the Democratic Republic of Congo, and according to the authorities, it was the largest ever found in the country. The motive behind the trade is money. The price of ivory tusks that costs the lives of so many African elephants was around $13 million.
Just touch on the hair alone, they can feel it. It is very sensitive. Spiky.
The global trade in elephant ivory has been mostly outlawed since 1989.
Some interesting views here. The World Wildlife Fund estimates that around 20,000 African elephants are being killed every year for their ivory. That's around 55 every day. And conservationists here and elsewhere hope that more can be done to protect them. Back to you, Debula.
Thanks, Chantel. Now let's turn from one of the biggest creatures on the planet to one of the smallest, a tiny bug most of us wouldn't notice, the beetle. Scientists are looking through their microscopes at how the beetle could help them harvest water from thin air.
Meet the fog-stand beetle, our new ally in tackling water scarcity. The creature is native to Africa's Namib Desert. It's one of the world's most arid areas. But what it lacks in rainfall, it makes up for with coastal fog. And that's what our beetle depends on for its survival. It basks in the fog, standing with its head down on top of sand dunes. The beetle's bark is covered in bumps with water-loving tips and water-repelling slopes. So tiny droplets of fog stick to the surface, and as they coalesce, gravity pulls them down the beetle's bark and into its mouth. There are several fog collecting projects around the world. Scientists in the UK are replicating the beetle's bark with roof tiles. The tiles could trap fog water and help hospitals in parts of Africa collect sterile water to make medicines.
Wow, so cool. So we've had wildlife giants and tiny anthropods. Now let's get more on mammals of mixed sizes that have been making tracks this week. And we start over in East Africa, in Kenya and Tanzania, where the Maasai giraffe has been classed as endangered. There are now only 35,000 of them left in the wild. Conservationists say the population has almost halved in 3 decades and has called it a wake-up call to the effects of poaching and the loss of habitat. Next, to Scotland in the UK, where a rare animal nicknamed the Highland Tiger has been born. Now, you might think they look just like domestic cats, right? In fact, these two wildcat kittens are so rare, they're in danger of becoming extinct. With only 35 of them left, it's hoped that they will one day be released into the wild. And finally, over to the United States for some bird news. The cockatoo has become a social media sensation for his dance skills and ended up in a science magazine. The authors say they wonder how the snowball learned his moves, but he doesn't seem bothered, preferring to practice his shaku instead. Now, an environmental story with a cause. We all know solar power is a clean and renewable source of energy. But in Ethiopia, it's also being used to keep girls in school. And we've been to meet one of the thousands of teenagers there who have been given a lantern on one condition, that their parents keep them in the classroom and unmarried until they're 18. Amarash told us what a difference it's made to her life.
I use the solar lamp to study. My sister uses it too. We use it for light. I also use it as a charger and it has helped me. I charge 3 to 4 phones a day, 5 birr per phone, so I make 20 birr a day. I have been able to save money. I was given the lamp in September. By January, I had saved 1,200 birr and I bought a goat.
Amarash is 17 years old. 40% of girls in Ethiopia are married before 18, even though child marriage is illegal.
Outside of the urban areas, you may see child marriage at the age of 13, 14.
They receive cash income or a cattle from the families of the husband. So these girls are a source of income for the parents.
Solar lanterns are provided by an NGO called the Population Council. Before Amarash got hers, her father had to sign an agreement.
Her father made a pledge that we will allow her to learn and not marry her off, and we will help her finish school.
The lantern costs 800 birr, about $28.
We provided training on how to use the solar lantern, how to fix it when it has kind of technical issues, and also on how to use it to charge mobile phones. It changed them from being a burden to someone helping the family.
Study shows that girls in the early phases of the project were 3 times more likely to be in school.
I want to get married, but after I finished school and helped my family, after I've helped my sisters and brothers through school, and once I am independent.
Thanks, Renee. Now to something that sparks interest across the globe. Yes, politics. First, the pop star turned politician Bobby Wine has announced he will run for the job of president of Uganda in the 2021 election. The singer, who calls himself the ghetto president, but whose name is really Robert, says he plans to champion the poor, social justice, democracy, and of course, music. And in Tunisia, there's going to be a big change after the president of the country passed away. And Nora is here to tell us more. Hi, Nora.
Hi, Deb.
So people in Tunisia mourning.
Yes, they are. President Beji Caid Essebsi died at the age of 92. This is significant because at that age, it made him the oldest president in the world. But it was what he represented that was so important. He was the country's first freely elected leader. He became president after the Tunisian Revolution, which started in December 2010 as a reaction to high youth unemployment and corruption. These protests spread to other countries like Libya, Egypt, Yemen and Syria and became known as the Arab Spring. But unlike these countries, Essebsi managed to keep Tunisia democratically stable.
So what happens next then?
Well, 85-year-old Mohamed Ennasser, who was head of Tunisia's parliament, has stepped in as interim president. But, Deb, the question is, who will officially become Tunisia's next leader and how will they tackle the issues of security and economy? We'll find out after the elections in September.
Thanks, Nora. Now, let's meet someone who overcame the bullies at school and is now one of the faces of Rihanna's brand. Kudya Diop was so ashamed of her skin once that she didn't want to leave her house. But now she calls herself the Melanin Goddess and has made it big in the US as a fashion model. She's been speaking to my colleague Atta in Senegal from the BBC radio show Salam Moment.
There was a time you wanted to stop going to school because that.
Oh, yeah. Definitely.
What happened exactly?
Like, I would wake up and not even feel like I wanted to see anyone because I would be like, I would try to like read their minds, and I would always tell myself, all these people are thinking that you're ugly. Because, like, growing up, the only thing I would hear people say is, like, dark is ugly. And they still say that. They still, like, when they say a dark-skinned girl, they like, say ugly after that. Mm. And being dark-skinned was just, like, a sign of poverty. My family helped me a lot, like, realize that my skin was beautiful, because I would come home crying or, like, fighting or something, and they would be like, don't do this, you know? Yeah, I remember my sister would always tell me, like, you have the darkness of the night, and that's beautiful. Like, without the darkness, you can't see the stars and stuff. And she would always try to lift my mood and stuff. And I thought that was funny, but really uplifting at the same time. From my journey, if I had to give 5 advices to anyone, is to believe yourself first, learn about yourself second, third, embrace who you are and embrace everyone else. And fourth, be patient with yourself. Don't be really hard with yourself. Like, talk to yourself as you would talk to a child. Mm-hmm. And fifth, just know that self-love is a process. And, you know, take it time by time, but just love yourself. You don't have to envy anyone about anything. Just do you, be you, and love you.
Sifa kwa Mola wangu Maulana. Kwa mengi aliyofanya, dimi nawe kukutana kisura.
Yo, what's good? This is Ray Vanny, V, Vanny Boy from WCB Wasafi. You're watching BBC What's New.
Now, you may have seen the news this week about the latest terror attack in northern Nigeria, where dozens of people were killed by the extremist group Boko Haram. But who are they and why are they doing this? Here's Andre to explain.
Yes, thanks, Tabula. This month marks an anniversary that no one will be celebrating. It's been a decade since the militant group Boko Haram started their campaign of terror in Nigeria. Now, that's since spread to countries including Chad, Cameroon and Niger. But who are they and where did they come from? I've been finding out more.
It started in 2002 with one man, Muhammad Yusuf, a radical Muslim cleric who wanted a place in which to preach his beliefs. He found it in northern Nigeria, in Maiduguri, where he started a school. There he taught a strict form of Islamic law. It was to become a recruiting ground for his followers. They came to be known as Boko Haram. In Hausa, it means Western education is forbidden, and they believe that taking part in anything considered Western, from wearing certain clothes to voting in elections, is a sin, and anyone who disagrees with them, even other Muslims, is considered an enemy, including Nigeria's president. 7 years after the school opened, in 2009, the group started a campaign of violence. They attacked police and government buildings. Nigeria's security forces fought back, and Muhammad Yusuf was killed. But Boko Haram did not die. A new leader emerged, Abubakar Shekau, and the violence spread. Boko Haram now targeted police, politicians, and members of the public. They started bombing churches, bus ranks, and bars in northern and central Nigeria. The government declared a state of emergency in three states, and pursued by the army, the group abandoned their birthplace and fled to the border with Cameroon and Chad. Camouflaged by forests, Boko Haram attacked villages there and forced boys to join them. Girls suffered too. 276 teenagers were kidnapped from their school in Chibok, causing outrage across the world. Campaigns were launched to call for action to help bring them back, but 5 years on, 112 girls are still missing. In all, the group is thought to be holding around 2,000 children captive.
Well, Tabula, the military in Nigeria has had some success tackling Boko Haram. People have been rescued, their territory has been reduced, and the group itself has split into smaller parts. But of course, they are still seen as a major threat to Nigeria's security.
It's smart home in Italy, but now it's arrived in Nigeria. And we're not talking about pasta, pizza or pistachio. We're talking about opera. But in a bid to win over fans in Africa, it's being sung in pidgin. Keisha, what didn't happen?
Yes, I'm in Lagos, where I've been watching a musical of a different kind, one that burst onto the scene 500 years ago. But it hasn't been popular here in Nigeria, and one woman is trying to change that.
It's amazing.
Beautiful.
Just like, wow.
It's dramatic, heartfelt, and empowering. This is opera, originally from Italy, but now here in Nigeria and in pidgin.
Could you pick any of the many dialects we speak here? Why that one?
I thought it would be a really fun way to engage the most people because pidgin is spoken by the most people in Nigeria, probably Africa. So it was a way for me to bring the two together, to marry them.
And in terms of what makes a great opera performance, can you share with my audience?
I think an opera performance is one that is confident and one that is can be fiery. So for example,
sinking at it, make you want. I'm sinking at it, tell them. Man, I may not go die like so.
Wow. During Song Queen, we see you playing a rather unique looking instrument. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, it's my amazing instrument called the hung, and I love it. It's my favorite instrument in the world. It looks like a flying saucer. It sounds like a harp, but you play it with your hands. And can I bring it over?
Yeah, sure.
So, it has a little ding here and the notes on the side. So in opera, many of the performers, the singers, don't play instruments, but I'm playing so. So if we do a little, if you maybe just hit those two notes together.
Not very good.
There you go.
Yeah.
One way to make sure more people get familiar with opera is to introduce it to a younger audience. The cast are performing a special matinee for school kids in Lagos, and I've come to see it.
It's my first time at the opera, and for a lot of the children here today, it will be theirs as well. I'm going to talk to some of the children to find out what they're expecting from today's pidgin opera.
This is actually my first time at an opera.
And I'm thinking what they're going to do here is singing.
I think an opera is something like the acting.
The show's about to start, and I'm really excited to see the first pidgin opera in Nigeria. So let's get going.
I'm
the Mene tribe, they sing a peaceful reality in earth through the songs that they sing. The world of the stars become envious of the people of earth and the prosperity, send temptations. The Mene lose their voice, and the aim is to find the peace song, the opera finale, that unites the worlds.
That was incredible. For my first opera, I had a fantastic time. But let's find out what our young audience thought of the first Nigerian pidgin opera.
They made my day. I'm really excited.
Everything about it was great. I love the show.
The performance was really okay, and I guess there will be a lot to tell at school when I get to school.
So the kids loved it, and Helen has high hopes for the opera's future in Nigeria.
I thought about bringing the opera, the pidgin opera, to Nigeria because it's never been done before, and I wanted a way to celebrate Nigerians, celebrate Africans without, you know, being too formal about it. I wanted something fun and something engaging.
Well, it was a bravo from me for Helen. And in case you're wondering what Helen is wearing in her hair, she explains that she calls it her Venus bushfire. And it's an artistic representation of balance and nature inspired by acacia trees. Something to try, perhaps, Dabula. Back to you in the studio.
Yes, perhaps I will try, Keisha, although I don't think I'll be giving the opera a go, especially as I'm not as good as this guy. That's Menzingoma. He used to be a cab driver but has found his true calling. A passenger filmed the Uber driver in his cab in Durban, South Africa. The video went viral. And the 27-year-old is now going to Los Angeles in the US to perform in a talent show. Good luck, Menzi. Lovely voice. Well, that's all for us from now. But don't forget, in the meantime, you can find more from the What's New team on our YouTube page. Just go to youtube.com/BBC What's New and make sure you hit the subscribe button to keep up to date with all our latest interviews and stories, and comment on your favorite ones. See you next week. Bye.